Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. Chief Liddy, we have the recovery of cost report first.
Since the ordinance was revamped in last summer, we have visited seven different properties and issued citations for either breach of peace or creating a public disturbance. That resulted in six different landlords, one owned two properties, receiving a warning letter, basically putting them on notice. And what that means is that if at any time during approximately the next 2.5 years, we return, we in fact make an arrest, and there is a conviction in court, we would be billing the landlords or owners of the property for law enforcement calls. So that hasn't happened to date, but there are six different landlords that are on notice.
Thank you. Anyone have questions for Chief Lee? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next up is the Affordable Housing Report. Excuse me a sec. Would you mind introducing yourself?
Oh, I'm sorry. Seth DeMarco. I'm the Vice Chair of the Affordable Housing Committee.
Thanks.
But I was saying we provided written comments on several set-aside developments in town. So specifically, 1521 Beacon View Drive and 980 High Street. We also reviewed and provided written comments on the TOD development and recommended to increase the inclusionary set-aside requirement from 10% to 11 to 12%. We also provided comments on the proposal to establish a payment in lieu option to satisfy inclusionary zoning. We have continued to monitor the housing unit equivalency points to seek out moratorium. And recently we've met with local housing providers to discuss projects where we can use the housing trust fund. And as of December 31st, that balance was $673,880.
Thank you. Anybody have questions? Representative Iacono.
Pam Iacono, District 8. I had a question about regulations and whether or not the new assisted living facilities that we have in town, is there, in other towns, are they, were they permissible to have a set aside for affordable on that? Would that have happened in Fairfield, or am I misunderstanding what I had learned from some other places?
Mark Barnhart, Director of Community Economic Development. At present, our zoning regulations do not cover assisted housing developments, assisted living facilities as part of the inclusionary zoning set aside. We are aware that the town of Wilton does have a provision that does encompass assisted living facilities, and we're looking at their regulatory scheme to determine whether or not we might amend our regulations further to cover assisted living facilities as part of that.
Okay, so that is something that
that's the only community I'm aware of that does that.
That's what I had understood as well, that they did that. And then you can't go back, obviously, then retroactively.
Not
that would just be for any developments that come forward.
Correct.
And how close are we? Are we? Can you get just walk us through this chart a little bit? You talked about the moratorium and the numbers and how far away we are from reaching that.
Sure. Under the statutes, you can count units that have been placed into service or newly de-restricted after July 1st, 1990, towards your housing, your temporary housing moratorium. The points that are needed are based on the last decennial census, and 2% of the housing units in town at that time, which requires, in the case of Fairfield, 433 points. It is estimated that we currently have 341.5 points at present time. There are another 129.5 points potentially available to us that are in progress. Those are for projects that are either in construction or have been approved and are expected to move forward into construction. Importantly, we can't actually count the units or the points associated with those units until such time as they've been issued a certificate of occupancy. So it would appear, even though we're closing in on the necessary point totals, that we would have more than enough to file for our first moratorium based on the units already existing and those in progress. It still, it would appear, based on where we are at present, that that's at least a year or so away. When we can actually count those units towards those moratorium points.
And then what happens with the 830G projects that are in line?
If
we reach the moratorium, if they're in line in process, how does that work?
My understanding is if they've already made an application, they're already pending, the moratorium would not cover them. It would only cover those that are submitted subsequent to the town being granted the moratorium by the state.
And I had a question on the housing trust fund, too. You said you're looking at things to do with the $600,000 that's in there, or you want it to grow more. What are some of the things that you're looking at doing?
The committee's had conversation with several housing providers relative to the potential use of housing, the housing trust fund monies. One of the projects that we've been considering, things that we've done in the past, is acquisition and rehab of existing multifamily units, 2, 3, 4 family units in town, assisting a local housing provider with both the acquisition and rehab costs associated with that return for covenant a restriction that would basically de-restrict that unit for 40 years so that we would get the points associated with that. That seems like the most, the easiest provision or application of those funds, but there are other potential uses, including potentially for creation of assisted dwelling units to assist homeowners in creating assisted dwelling units or accessory units in an existing house, or for potentially a redevelopment of existing property to provide for additional units. But ground-up development typically is pretty expensive, and $670,000, while it sounds like a lot, is not really much to do a major redevelopment project.
And when else have any questions? Representative Vergara.
Hi, Jill Vergara, District 7. What's the policy behind only allowing housing units to go towards the point requirements that were built after 1990?
I don't know. I think this is in state statute. It's something that we have mentioned to our legislative delegation and other state housing advocates in the State Department of Housing in the past. It seems a little arbitrary in terms of the July 1st date, but that is the law at present, so we can only count those units placed in the service after.
Do you know how many we have that pre-exist that date?
A number of those, including some major developments at Parish Court, some McKinney, things of that nature. So it's been brought up before. I don't expect statutes to change with respect to it, but something that obviously runs me and the other members of the committee. Well, doesn't seem something quite right.
Me as well. I also wanted to see how many points we get for senior housing, senior affordable housing. Is it the same as regular housing, affordable housing?
There was a statutory change a few years back that did provide, I don't have the statute in front of me, but does equalize the point total provided that you have a certain number of multifamily units as part of your application, which we do. So the senior units would count as a point.
And you referenced two applications that you had submitted statements for, but you didn't say what the position of the committee had been for those two applications. Could you review it with us and let us know what your thoughts were regarding Beacon View and 980 High Street?
Well, I don't have the information in front of me, but for Beacon View Drive, that development initially was a 27-unit set-aside development, and then they came back and proposed a 20-unit set-aside development. And while we recognize that the town does need affordable housing, we didn't feel that the development fit within the character of the neighborhood. And we also recognize that there are a concentration of affordable developments in that neighborhood. And we commented that we felt that there should be development should be in other places of the town as opposed to just one specific area. On High Street, again, we recognize the need for housing. That development is being done by the Fairfield Housing Authority, and Carol Martin has a really good track record of development. She did the Pine Tree development, which is really just an outstanding project. But we also recognize that the neighbors have concerns about that, and we're including that in comments.
Did you have an issue with it being 40 units, or that didn't seem too dense to your committee?
I don't think we had an issue. I don't think we had an issue with that.
Well, thank you for tracking the concentration in town of certain affordable housing units and referencing that, because I think it's a really important issue to have a handle over. Thank you.
Are there other questions, Representative Gottlieb?
Hi, Julie Gottlieb, District 5. If we were to obtain a moratorium for any of some of the persons that are a member, how long would that be in effect for?
It's a 4-year period.
Representative Allen, thank you.
Are all these units all rental? Or are there any special mortgages you can maybe get through military or government, or any of these affordable housing units ownership, or is it all rental?
They're both represented in our total. So there are at least closing in on 50 ownership units as part of our total.
Are there any other questions? Representative Gerber?
Okay. Bill Gerber, District 2. Mark, question on the point system. The points are based on the number of units, and at the end of the moratorium, at the end of the 4-year term, I guess the points, do they reset based on the total number of housing units in town? So to be like a new percentage of the total housing units? Is it a moving target?
In order to secure a second moratorium, we would need to go through the same process again and accumulate sufficient points to qualify under the statute. So in that regard, it does reset. We have to constantly provide for additional units, and that's part of our overall strategy is looking at our existing housing stock and figuring out ways in which we can utilize that.
Okay, so So if, at the end of the four-year moratorium, if you were to get it, assuming that there's been a fair amount of development and that we haven't sort of kept pace with the percentages that we need to be fully compliant, it sounds like the chances are that the total number of points you need for a second moratorium would be greater than
the total points is based on the last census, so the total number of housing units, 2% of the total number of housing units in town. So we have a census coming up in 2020, so I would expect that we'll have new figures on which we'll have to base that future application on. So I think from our standpoint, it's important that we try to get that application in soon, based on the 2010 census.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Representative McDermott.
Yeah, McDermott, District 7. You mentioned here in the report that you're investigating the opportunity to create affordable housing through a tax relief or other program by 2017, which obviously has passed. Have any of your committee members come to the Senior Tax Relief Committee meetings, and what are you suggesting here by that statement?
In the plan, there was discussion about ways in which we might be able to utilize accessory dwellings or accessory apartments towards a moratorium application or to create affordable units in general. And since we already have, unlike some other communities that have done so and used that to satisfy their affordable housing requirements, we already have a permissive language in our zoning regs to allow for those units to be created but not be restricted. They don't count as affordable housing units currently. The thought was, how best can we incentivize homeowners to place a covenant or restriction on their units such that we would get credit for those affordable accessory housing units? And the thought was, perhaps we could provide some kind of tax credit or some other type of property tax relief in exchange for a covenant or restriction. At the time, we were also pairing that with some proposed amendments to our zoning regulations to make it a little easier to create accessory dwelling units, and that unfortunately did not come to pass. We are presently working with Fairfield Senior Advocates to propose those changes to our zoning regulations. I think it would make sense at that time to revisit this question and see whether or not flexibility in creating those units such that there would be some kind of monetary incentive for people to do this. Because otherwise, I don't see why someone would voluntarily put a deed restriction on their house. In some other communities, they didn't have, there was no legal right to create an accessory dwelling or an accessory apartment. And so they basically provided amnesty in exchange for this deed restriction. Right under our zoning regulations, but it doesn't require any kind of covenant or restriction to make it affordable. So that was the thinking behind the comment and the plan. So again, we didn't get very far with the zoning regulatory change. It was kind of like the any members that have actually attended the tax relief.
Well, I have not had an opportunity to be present at the meetings, but I know committee members do try to attend other meetings that are happening in town that deliver to affordable housing, and we do keep updating to what goes on at different meetings in the town. And Mark has been very good about keeping us informed.
And Fagara.
Hi, Jill Fagara, 6-7. I just have one last question about that list on your progress report. I wanted to see if you could explain point number 8, the adoption of an incentive housing zone. I just wanted to see if you could flesh that out for me.
Sure.
So we had applied for funding through the State Department of Housing, and part of that, those funds went towards hiring consultants to prepare an update to the affordable housing plan. As part of that, we specifically looked at the creation of incentive housing zones, which was something that the state had crafted. It didn't really apply as well here as perhaps other locations. We already had a density bonus in effect in our zoning regulations. We did make some proposed changes to it to make it a little bit more flexible, which is what this reference is too. So we kind of have something that already predated, that already existed in our zoning regulations that in effect provides for an incentive housing zone, if you will, something like it, but it's not, doesn't technically meet the state's definition of that. And unfortunately, it's not really sufficient to provide for an incentive for developers to use that in lieu of filing a set-aside application in late to reject. So that's, I think, something that we are continuing to explore with zoning staff and the commission in light of the recent flurry of applications pursuant to late to reject, to provide some mechanism by which we can have an alternative. Currently, there isn't sufficient density in the regs to provide for an economic incentive to do that. So, clearly, developers are using the 830G statute to accomplish their objectives. And they don't have something in the regs that provides a reasonable alternative. So, that's why I think we want to continue to look at that.
Was this a way for to get developers to do these kinds of affordable housing units in areas that they're not developing right now, to try to push it out into other areas of the town, since it's so concentrated in one area? Is that the goal of something like this?
No, not necessarily. I think we currently have in our zoning regs design residence district overlay and a density bonus within that. Has to meet certain qualifications, criteria in order to qualify, to apply, to be designated as such. But the underlying density is inadequate to actually prompt people to do that in lieu of making an application related to the GDP. So it's something I think we should take a look at to determine whether or not there is some other path forward as opposed to playing defense against all these set-aside developments on the that was part of the thinking behind creating an inclusionary zoning regulation, and that has helped to some degree, but we still have seen a lot of activity. And not all of these applications under ATG are necessarily bad applications. There are some that are in locations that might be suitable for that type of high density housing, but committee vice chair reference speaking, that's clearly in a very congested neighborhood already, and there's some significant safety concerns as it relates to traffic and how we handle traffic in that neighborhood. So again, there might be locations where it might be more appropriate. We'd like to at least think of a way in which we can provide an alternative to making having developers make these applications in the
Thank you. Thank you. We have Mr. Bateson, who's an ex officio member of RTM, because he's on the Board of Finance, and he has a question or two.
Thank you. Quick thing. It looks like we're going to achieve credits for a moratorium before we meet again next year, possibly. If so, the mechanism for the moratorium, is that self-actuating, or does the town department or agency have to apply for it?
We have to make an application and provide documentation substantial to the town. It would probably be through my office working in conjunction with the town attorney.
Okay. Number two, there's $673,000. Do you guys have a statement of fund position, or is there something you put together? I'd like to see the activity. You know, we've gone from somewhere like 75,000 last year to 673. I guess what I'd like to see for the 12-month period, January 1st to December 31st, is just what happened with all the money.
We haven't made any disbursements from the fund
yet,
so we would report that through this body, through the Board of Selectmen, actually, with recommendations for disbursements of funds.
Okay, so there's been no disbursements?
No disbursements to date.
Okay.
Thank you.
Representative Durrell.
Keep building. There we go. I'm Alex Durrell, RTM3. What's the average time frame from soup to nuts for buying a property, going at an 830Z, getting approval, having it built, getting the certification of occupancy? I mean, there's got to be, is it 2 years, 4 years? There's got to be some, not necessarily standard, but within a standard deviation. I'm sure we've had enough of them.
I would think that 2 years would be moving at light speed. To acquire property, design it, get it approved through the permitting process, get construction plans, go out, actually construct a project, fully get a certificate of occupancy. I'd say 3 years might be a more realistic time frame for that, moving quickly.
Do we have any towards the finish line?
Well, there are a number that are actually in construction, so those are mostly inclusionary units. There's a very small 830G development at 1675 Post Road under construction. We have an inclusionary project at 333 Encore Road. We have the Trademark 2 development, which is under construction, which again is covered under inclusionary requirements. So there's a number of projects that are actively in construction that should be completed in the next 12 months, I would guess. But in terms of other projects that are just now, for example, 185 Thorpe Street, which is an age restricted independent living project, was just recently approved this past month. It's not uncommon for it to apply for a building permit, get your financing probably in the 4 to 6 month time frame, so that might be breaking ground sometime later this year, and 18 to 24 month construction cycle as well. So it does take a while to get these projects to the finish line, as you put it.
Okay.
Oops, Representative Pistilli.
Sharon Pistilli, District 3. I apologize, I arrived a little bit late, so I've been moving at Ward just before this, so if I miss this and it's a rerun, I apologize in advance. Is it possible that as these developments are coming online, that we're actually falling further behind in terms of Section 830G compliance? Like, is it possible that the ratio of units and residents doesn't work out quite the way we thought, so the more units that are coming online with the ratio the way it is, we're actually falling further away from the goal? Or is the ratio, the way the statute's written, the ratio is such that we will, as each development comes online, we are still coming towards the goal? Do you understand? Like, the denominator and the numerator can change depending on how many actual people live in the units.
Right. So, if you're creating projects under the state statute 830G, only 30% of those of those units are affordable, and 70% are market rate. So, using your math, that's something I've raised to the Commissioner of Housing in the past. It is currently the state law, so I'm not sure there's much that we can do about it other than continue to pursue changes. We have not seen a dilution of the number, the percentage of units, because we're, in terms of meeting the 10% requirement, we're at 2.7% roughly. So I think that would be more an issue as you if you were closer to the 10% goal. I think I would agree with you. I think that's it's kind of like you're on a hamster wheel to some degree. That's not to say that we shouldn't be trying to create some affordable and accessible units for our resident base that desperately need this type of housing. But I do think the 10% goal is somewhat of an unrealistic goal for the vast majority of the communities in the state. I've said that repeatedly. But it is the law that we work under at the present time.
And then another question. When the High Street development, when I became aware of that, I made a quick little chart of like the percentage of students who receive subsidized lunch, because part of the goal of affordable housing is to have affordable housing in different neighborhoods across town. And you know, we've already had this discussion where the developments end up in the same neighborhood or neighborhoods because of the already existing density and because the land is less expensive. Is there a strategy to try to spread out, affordable housing developments so that it is across, different neighborhoods?
That was really the thinking behind the inclusionary zoning regulation that provides that if a private developer or any developer is going to create housing results in 10 or more units, then there should be a set aside within that development as affordable. We set it as 10%, and it seems to be sufficient for the market to bear that. But the thought was that it would be naturally produced as private housing construction goes forward, and it would be scattered throughout town, so it would not be, no one neighborhood would necessarily be disproportionately disadvantaged by hosting a number of these developments. That hasn't necessarily held up under 830G, because you'll see case was a good example. We've seen a number of projects in that particular area, and such that we did make that concern. And we also noted in our letter to the committee's letter to the Planning and Zoning Commission, not that there was much that the commission could do about it, but it was something we felt was noteworthy that we should comment upon.
Okay, and then only one last thing. I just want to bring to everybody's attention, there was an article in the New Haven Register on February 12th that happened to catch my eye. The town of Guilford, the residents overwhelmingly voted to donate a piece of land for the use of affordable housing. So in order to spread out Section 830G projects, has the town looked at land that we're not using that we could donate or set aside for that purpose, and we could raise the ratio ourselves and make that a stipulation to at least the land to a developer so that, we're not the hamsters on the treadmill and we're meeting the goal faster?
We have done that before. The town has donated its own property and used that for purposes of creating affordable housing. It's, I think we've perhaps exhausted the most obvious candidate sites, but there may be others that you're aware of that we should take a closer look at within the town's inventory, and that's something I think the committee is ready and willing and able to do that.
Okay, thank you. That's all I have. Thanks a lot.
Anyone else? Okay, thank you very much. The next item is the appointment to FairTV for Mr. Vishnu. So you want to come up and chat? If you could just tell us very briefly about your, what you do and why you're interested in this position.
Hi, I'm Alex Vishnu. I among other things, do video production. I work with a lot of businesses, some musicians, though as much as I love music, being a musician myself, I try to avoid them. I'm a creative person. I went to school undergrad and have a master's degree in both for music and both. And I later went back to school for an MBA, and I realized how challenging the business So I filmed a ton of business conferences that I've produced. I've had film people come and, you know, film them. And one of the sort of issues that I always found when filming conferences, for example, was that they were boring to watch. So, you know, being a musician, you have very little time to capture somebody's attention. And I've sort of taken that idea into the video work that I do. I always try to focus on, you know, entertaining the viewer, no matter what the content, if it's creative, educational, you know, or marketing. That's kind of always my goal. And I became aware of FairTV recently, and I went and looked at some of the content. And how many of you have watched FairTV recently? Okay. And so, you know, I think that there's some great content that's important, just like what's happening here in the discussion I just heard. I would love to explore if there's a way to deliver that more in a more palatable way to viewers so that they might get it quicker. Because does anybody here check out social media from time to time? How much time do you spend watching a video? A couple seconds before you move on to the next one, and the next one after that, and maybe, you know, 20 or 30 videos through, you actually spend a minute watching one. So my question is then, how much time are people, normal people who, you know, you are representing, how much time are they spending watching what you're, you know, delivering? And I think it would be an interesting, you know, question to pose to, you know, the commission. How much are people watching? Can we make it more palatable? Can we make your message, you know, easier to understand and so inform more people and so on? So those are some of the kind of ideas that I have.
If you can make one of these meetings really exciting, I wanna see it. Representative Georgiadis. Georgiadis, District 9. Can you explain to me the word palatable? Because to me, palatable, this is content. So palatable means it's not taste, doesn't taste well. It sticks in your mouth. It's not digestible. And I would hope that we don't want to sensationalize information, because this is not marketing, this is not sales. This is, you know, it's probably a C-SPAN. It is a bit dry, but
I think it's a fair
the word is an issue.
I certainly believe that everything you guys are doing here is important. When I say palatable, I mean something that somebody can, in fact, digest in the time frame that they may have to watch and be a part of it. So, for example, you know, maybe there are some highlights of a meeting like this one that might be put together post-meeting to say, hey, you know, we don't need to hear from this guy now. We have all this really interesting housing discussion to do. So that's, when I say palatable, I really mean, you know, length and speed at which you can ingest and digest.
So now you're recommending you are the editor, so you get to select what information is seen. If you take a clip and you shorten it, then who gets to determine what each person wants to see. So I'm not sure if I agree with that, because some people are interested in some things, some people are interested in other things, and I would hate to have all the selected officials or someone who's not elected select what they deem palatable.
Well, I certainly have lots to learn within this venue, and there are unfortunately other people on the committee, on the commission, who can help educate me as to, you know, these kind of ideas and thoughts that are important. And so, you know, I'm coming at it with an open mind, and when I do edit a project that somebody hires me to do, for example, I do, in fact, have to make decisions, and I'm the one who has to make them, and, you know, theoretically hired to do that. In this scenario,
Next week we can take public comments. Representative Iacono.
Thanks, Alex. I'm really glad you're coming on with me. I think you're going to be a great asset, and I understand the other representatives' concern, because we do gavel to gavel for our meetings. That's the way the whole ordinance is set up. But, however, I see where you're going with this, and I don't think it would be such a bad thing to, for example, utilize a Facebook page to promote an RTM meeting and get somebody to click on it and drive them to watch whatever section of the meeting that might be of interest to them. So I think there is some value added to, you know, where you're going and what you're thinking. So thank you. I'm looking forward to having somebody with your experience. We've had repeated equipment failures. Would love to have you on the committee to, you know, voice your opinion on what we're using as for this, you know, rather antiquated, and where we need to be going and what we need to be doing and what the functions are with funding and those types of things. I've had conversations with some other members about maybe tweaking some things. So it'll be great to have you as an additional on the committee. So thank you for stepping up and being willing to volunteer.
Thank you.
I did want to just put in my two cents that I want to echo Representative Georgiadis' concern that even showing segments of the meeting or any kind of editing could implicate opinions, and, you know, it just could question what the whole context was of whatever said. So I think there'd have to be great care taken if that was to be done. Representative Ringel?
Hi there, Marissa Ringel, District 10. Thank you, Alex, for coming out and talking about FairTV. I appreciate what you were talking about also with the palatable word, what I would call more engaging. That's something that I actually work on presentations with my job, and just working with backdrops and lighting and angles can sometimes make something more engaging. But I agree with the editing comment that that gets very tricky. Where to edit and where not, and that could be subjective. So that would be something that we probably would not want to go into editing too much, but enhancements to get people to be more engaged and watch it longer, and actually participation in these meetings. There's I think, an opportunity for FairTV to run some kinds of listings of what meetings are happening in town that week in a very interesting music video type way or whatever, but to get public attendance up and engagement up, I think, is a, you know, great opportunity where we can really, really utilize your skills and draw attention to these meetings. Thank you.
Representative Vergara.
Hi, Mr. Vishnu. Thank you so much for volunteering to serve. I also have concerns about editorializing, and it raises the issue of having to kind of scrutinize applicants' backgrounds or what their views are, or doing some kind of litmus test for people to make sure that they're neutral if you're going to be editorializing, which leads me to a question that I didn't really want to get into, but if you're thinking of going a next step and wanting to maybe engage in some kind of editorializing, I would want to know if you have produced any kind of political ads or anything like that. So I don't want to ask those questions, but I'm saying if you're going into that area of wanting to take FairTV, which is supposed to be very independent, and it's not supposed to be pure content and has nothing to do with any of the producers' opinions. If it starts to, though, we're going to have to start asking questions about where people are coming from.
I simply want to make it enjoyable to watch. That's all. So as far as, you know, editing, we can take that right off the table. To be.
Have you produced political ads?
Yes.
How many?
11.
For whom?
For the RTM. For the Republican
side. Exclusively? I mean, in terms of the political party. You've done political ads exclusively for the Republicans. Okay, thank you.
Representative Wolk.
Jay Wolk, District 5. Just to let everybody know that by federal law, you cannot edit meetings.
Jeff Steele, District 2. I think we've all established our feelings on editing, so we'll not even discuss it anymore. And frankly, that's not the job of this body to determine what the FairTV Commission should do. So it's great that everyone has their comments. I want to thank you for coming forward for this position, because I think what we need is energetic, experienced people. I mean, you're right here on your resume. Video producer, editor, event producer, marketing director. Perfect. You have passion. You have experience. I myself am in the music world, so I appreciate that. If there's anything you can do to better excite us about the shows we watch on Channel 78, 79, that'd be great. Whatever you can do. So these are just ideas. You're spitballing right now. I think that's fine. But I think most importantly, you have experience, interest, passion, and the opportunity to do this. So I think that's great.
Anyone else? Representative Ringel.
What is the Ringel RTM District 10? I just wanted to say that in the presentation, Rob, I also have worked on both parties' presentations, and when it's your job, you'll take whatever's going to pay you sometimes. So that's all. Sounds like you the same. Would, if I was a Democrat hiring you to do the Democratic Town Committee work, would you take the video work?
Yep.
I thought so.
Listen, there's no Biden. I know you don't all know me, and I know there are concerns with, you know, parties and everything, but I'm just interested in doing a good job. I think Fairfield's a great town. I really appreciate everyone I've met here. My first, second, fifth, 100th question isn't what party are you from when I meet somebody and get to know them. I'm coming at this from just by the questions I've heard from, you know, the people before me on things that I do know matter to people here at Fairfield, I thought it was really interesting, and I think that I hope that, you know, more people in town engage in these questions, and if FairTV is able to help bring that message to them, everything you guys are discussing and asking here on both sides of the parties, I think that that's great. That's it. And, you know, how to make that happen in a way that, you know, continues to
Representative Pistilli.
Chairman Pistilli, District 3. I was just wondering if you could write a scripts. Maybe it'll help
you. Anyone else? Thank you very much for coming. You don't need to come next week, because we were all able to meet you this week. So we vote next week.
Did I get the job?
You'll find out next week.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thanks.
I'm going to scramble the presentation schedule a little and ask if Ms. Bossy and Mr. Sastrom could talk about the bonds. I apologize, Mr. Cleary, but we'll get to you shortly. Ms. Bossy, I'm wondering if before we start, even though this isn't the first thing we'll talk about, if you could just very briefly explain the waterfall, because we have a lot of new members who may not be familiar with that.
Okay, so you guys have probably heard the word waterfall before. Essentially, if you look at it, it's our debt schedule over the next 20, 30 years, by fiscal year, by principal, interest, and a lot of the numbers in the out years come from the capital plan workshop meeting that the Board of Finance puts on every September, October of every year. So what they do is they incorporate all of the wish list or the projects coming down the pipe from both the town and the Board of Ed side, put all the numbers together, look at some assumptions, how much we would bond every year, what we think the interest rates are going to be, and projects out what our debt service will be for the next 20 years or so, sometimes 30 out on the out years. So this refunding kind of comes into the waterfall due to the fact that we issued bonds back in 2012 and the interest rates are now more favorable. It's kind of like refinancing your mortgage. The projected savings are about $1.4 million or so over the next 10 or 11 years of this bond. The average interest rate on the bond is about 3.2%. The estimated interest rate that we think we can get next month or so is around 2%. So, or less, going down a little bit since we put these numbers together. The gross savings is about $1.4 million, and present value of that is about $1.2 million, and it represents about 6% of the refunded bond.
Representative Garskoff.
Hi, thanks. Josh Garskoff, District 5. Just to clarify, and we're not extending the life of any of these.
Correct.
And is the $1.4 million savings after any expenses? Are there any expenses like the refund?
There are some. That's all net of all the expenses incurred as well.
Thanks. Anyone else with a question? Representative Iacono?
Ms. Bossy, can you just walk us through very quickly on this chart sheet so that people know what was in the capital plan and what was added, what the differences are?
Well, we're talking about the refunding right now. I didn't bring the capital. That's coming up in the non-recurring.
So okay, so are you going to walk everybody through that when you come back?
The differences?
Yes.
I could. There is an exhibit, I believe, that talks about what was in there in September and what's coming forward as well.
Yeah. Wanted the new members to understand what the differences were between what was at the capital workshop and then what was out there.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Thank you both very much. We'll go to Mr. Cleary. The cardiovascular one was second.
Okay, so the preparedness grant is first. So this is one we've received for 18 years. It's a 5-year grant. And so it's $47,762 per year for each of 5 years. So this comes with a contract with the Department of Public Health, which outlines what deliverables need to be met.
Any questions about that? It was actually the second on the agenda, the medical care. Any questions about that grant? I got it mixed up. So please address the second one here.
So the preventative health block grant is another one we received for numerous decades. It's a 3-year grant. We have selected the
had a question about that. Have you, I imagine you have considered this, but having restaurants in town post-calorie count, I'm guessing that's expensive for them, but is that something you've considered as part of this?
I believe there's regulation out there that requires that if you're of a certain size, that you have to do that now. So, and again, this is part of that, I would say. You know, we haven't sort of taken up having regulatory authority to compel them at this point. We would need some kind of ordinance or something like that to compel them to do that. But this is a part of that where essentially these menu items would receive some kind of notation on their menu that would be described on their menu to say these are certain calorie criteria and that criteria. It's a part of that.
Yeah. Thank you. Any questions on this front? Okay, thank you very much. So now we'll go to the other bonds. If Ms. Bossy, if you're ready for that.
Two coming forward tonight, a 10-year and a 20-year. This exhibit kind of puts it all together so you can see the differences between the October 2019 on the right-hand side, what was proposed on the town side. These are town projects only. And now coming before you in January of 2020. As you'll see, there's a reconciliation box down at the bottom. So it starts off with the $2.2 million. Which lists about eight projects or so on the right-hand side. Those are all coming forward with the exception of the new fleet radio. That is delayed to a date uncertain at this point. So if you take out the $350 for that, all the other projects on the right-hand side are coming forward, in addition to the new ones that are listed below, five projects listed below, which are going to be spoken to this evening by various department heads. So that's the reconciliation on the town side. And if you just want to flip, there was no changes on the Board of Ed side between the October 19 meeting and tonight's capital non-recurring projects.
Thank you. Representative Gerber, I think he has a question for you.
I had a quick question. Bill Gerber, District 2, about HSR golf course renovation. This is part of the 10-year plan, right?
This is the last of the 10-year plan.
The last year. And so has this been capitalized every year?
Every year. There hasn't been exactly 10 years at 100, and I think Anthony was going to speak to this. We've spent some years, I think they skipped a couple, and 1 year was 75, but we're up to the end of our 10-year.
But it hasn't been expensed. It's all been... It's all been bonded.
Yeah.
It, like just looking at the description of it, I don't think I ever noticed this before, but it doesn't look like something that would be bonded.
Well, our bonding policy is 100,000 and over, between 100 and a million. So it's
even though this is like paving, fixing potholes and stuff.
Are you talking about the golf course renovation?
I thought that the description of that 10-year plan was not the HSR.
Oh no, these are greens, I believe.
Yeah, oh, these are greens. They're fixing greens, and yeah.
Anthony Calabrese, Director of Parks and Recreation. To Representative Gerber's question, yes, this is the pretty much the last year of the 10-year plan. So Board of Finance, RTM, Board of Selectmen all decided, obviously, a little over 10 years ago, they wanted a 10-year capital improvement plan, which included $1 million worth of renovations done at the course itself, meaning not the clubhouse. And this is at last year, so that does include park paths, reshaping greens, and tee boxes and things of that nature. So that's where we are with this last 100,000.
Okay, so this isn't something like when this is done, there's not going to be another 10-year plan.
There will be, just not yet. So what the Board of Finance asked us to do was not come back with another 10-year plan right away.
So you're going to see an increase in our operating budget to maintain the things we've done over this last 10 years. And then I would assume the next few years we'll come back with another 10-year plan. It just seems to be good business to do that.
Right. So I mean, I guess the Board of Finance is in agreement that this is capital improvements as opposed to ongoing maintenance sort of stuff you'd be doing.
It becomes ongoing maintenance. All the work that we're doing now, or we've done over the past 10 years, does need to be maintained. So that increases our operating budget.
Okay.
But this was how the Board of Finance decided, you know, 12, 13 years ago that this
is how they wanted to go about it. Okay, thanks.
You're welcome.
So I guess while you're here, we'll see if anyone else has questions first about the golf course renovation that we were just discussing. Representative Vergara.
Jill Vergara, District 7. I have a question about the original 10-year plan. It was supposed to be $1 million over those 10 years, but when you calculate it all together, it seems over that at this point.
There was 1 year where there is $150,000 for a pump station. That was never included in the 10-year plan. And that year, I believe, we also took a zero on the actual 10-year plan. Pump station needed to be done, so we did that in lieu of doing the $100,000. There's another year where I believe we actually took less. And again, I apologize, I don't have the numbers in front of me because I wasn't planning on coming up right now, but I can grab my book and go right through it. But it should be roughly $1 million. 10 years, $100,000.
It's over. I mean, because even if you don't include that year where we did the pump station, it totals $935,000 without this additional $100,000. So it's over by $25,000, which is nothing to sneeze at.
Okay.
Okay. So maybe we'll go. Were you planning to do it in order of the recurring capital expenses? So we would start with the transfer station. Is that what you were all figuring?
I think the bonds are done by the 10-year and 20-year, so I believe the 10 years should go first. For the night, if we let him just finish up his golf.
That's a good idea.
And then he doesn't have to hang out here.
So any more questions on the golf course? All right, that leaves us with the other item.
Tennis.
Tennis, thank you.
Tomlinson Tennis Courts was on the original waterfall chart. I'm happy to answer any questions. Right now that court is asphalt, for lack of a better term. We've been doing courts recently, Ludlow High School, we've been doing post-tension, and then we did Blake Tennis Courts post-tension as well. Post-tension, we get a 10-year guarantee on all the lines, and we get a 20-year track guarantee. Double the lifespan of what we currently do with the asphalt, which is about 10 to 12 years. So Tomlinson was done almost 12 years ago. Definitely at the end of its life, it's costing us between $30,000 to $60,000 every other year to resurface it. So it makes sense to do the post-tension. It might be.
Representative
McDermott, District 7. Mr. Calabrese, how many tennis courts do we have in town?
31.
And how many are redone in this new technology as opposed to the asphalt?
So far, there are 10. 4 at NAPS, Blake Courts at Fairfield Ward, and then the 6 at Ludlow High School. Those are the only 2 locations for those 10 courts between these two.
And the cost difference between these two technologies, I know that lifespan's a lot longer, but it's
about 20% more right now. But you recoup that after about 8 years is where the break-even point is, and then you go into the other side where you're basically not spending the money to maintain them to make that money back.
Okay. Do we have? I know we have outdoor basketball courts at Ward. Do we have them in Dwight, possibly?
Dwight, we have one court. Most of the elementary schools do have them. We have one at Palomar Park off of Highwood. I think those are the only ones off the top of my head. Most of the elementary schools.
Thank you.
Representative Georgiadis.
Foods are past District 9. Can you tell me who uses these courts? Because I'm familiar with, obviously, the high school usage. I'm familiar with most of the obstacle road. Can you tell me, are these used by residents only? Are they used for gym only? To what capacity and extent are these used?
Sure. Thomas is actually one of the more used tennis courts because the high school program, the sub-varsity program, plays over there. Obviously, Thomas in middle school, they do their own programs. The PE classes are out there. Any extracurricular activities that involve tennis, they do there. And then we've got some camps that we rent out the courts in the summer for. We do all our, many of our Pee Wee tennis programs are between Ludlow and Thomas and up at Ward. And then, yes, the general public does have access to those courts outside of the times that it's being used. We take reservations for them. People don't always make a reservation. If you drive by there on a Friday afternoon and nobody's playing, you're more than welcome to stop by and play. And all our courts have been lined for pickleball as well, which is becoming really popular. So with those double lines on there, we get pickleball play at Tomlinson as well.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Representative Steele.
Jeff Steele, District 2. Unless anyone has another question on the tennis court, I do have one question on the golf course. So you envision potentially another 10-year plan. What types of things are you thinking going forward that might need to be done that could be related to this? Any idea?
I don't have any idea off the top of my head. It's going to be, course-related. Obviously, it would have to be clubhouse-related with the brand new clubhouse being built. But I have to talk to the golf commission to see. We have a new golf chair and pretty much a brand new commission now, so they might have different ideas.
Okay.
Representative Vergara.
District 7. Why did we opt to do bituminous 10 years ago?
This is, post tension is fairly new to the Northeast. That's why. The technology, it's not really technology, there weren't too many places that were doing it in the Northeast. So now that they have done it and it's been around 10 to 20 years, you can see that they actually don't crack. So this is the trend that most municipalities have done.
Thank you. Anybody else? Thank you very much.
I appreciate your time.
Okay. So I think we'll go to Mr. Kelly next. This is for the land use and permitting injection system.
I'm Dan Kelly, Town IT Director. I have an item in there for $100,000 to stand up a new permitting licensing land use inspections system in town. Currently, the town has a fairly complex permitting process that's largely a paper process that does happen to be implemented on computers in some way, but it's a relatively difficult process for a resident or a contractor to navigate. Currently, there are about 7 departments involved in the permitting and inspection processes for the town, and all seven of those departments are using separate individual databases or software products, some of them commercial, some of them written by town staff over the past 25 years, none of which are really integrated or connect to each other or facilitate a workflow of moving a permit from one department to another. There are several departments involved in approving one. This proposal is to implement a single central system that all of these departments will share and will be online, web accessible, and make it possible for a resident or a contractor to even begin an application process for a permit online and ultimately pay the board fees and stuff like that. Keep them in constant communication in such a way that they know what the status of their permit is, and takes it from one step to another, or from one department to another, or gets bumped out for approval by a board and comes back approved. Currently, that's all kind of implemented in a manual way, and we're looking to automate that. Approximately a third of the towns in the state are already doing something like this. In fact, multiple departments in town and I have been having meetings throughout the spring, summer, and fall to edit an RFP that we borrowed actually from the Capital Region Housing Governance for a number of towns that already did a system like this. We just completed a go in 600 requirements for a system that we would like to see, and hand it over to the purchase department and leave them like to post it online tomorrow. Still on schedule. A system like this takes a long time to implement. We're hoping that we'll get to the RFP process, evaluate responses, select an actual vendor, and get ready to begin the implementation this summer. But we don't have firm numbers yet. $100,000 is an estimate based on proposals and some rough quotations that we've had from some vendors that have presented to us so far. But we won't know the actual numbers until we actually exercise the RFP.
Thank you. Any questions? Representative Steele.
Yes, Steele, District 2. Do you have a sense of whether there'll be any annual maintenance fees associated with
it? Yes, this is
what they would be.
Based on the, I think you actually have one of the example quotations in your packet in my 14 points, roughly $25,000 per year, but we are already paying that much for some existing commercial products that are in use. So once we get past the implementation, the first year of running the system, we already have in budget the ongoing operating costs we expect. Again, we don't have an actual vendor's book, but the exact number we expect to be roughly more. We're just hoping to get a much better, more useful system.
Representative Georgianis.
Georgianis, District 9. Good to see you again. You were here last month when we had MetroCog discuss the regional electronic content management system that they were offering us for free. So this cost $100,000. Did we determine that the free program would not satisfy your needs, and therefore this $100,000 with the $25,000 annual in maintenance costs is necessary right now, or do we know whether it's necessary or not currently?
The proposal for MetroCog is for a document imaging system, and they would be paying a vendor to try to develop some kind of a permitting system within a document management system. But I would equate that to building a bicycle versus buying a laptop. Yes, you have a device that has wheels that spin and move. But the permitting systems that we've already looked at, they represent hundreds of thousands of hours of labor. But the MetroCog proposal is a couple of hundred hours of labor to try to devise something. We did go to see a presentation at MetroCog more than a year ago now, with the idea of trying to develop a permitting inspection system from scratch using a document imaging system. We actually thought we were going to see a ready-to-run product. It was just a proposal to hire a contractor to write something. I think that nowadays, trying to develop any kind of software from scratch as a town, or even as any consortium with another town, is kind of pointless. Generally speaking, towns don't write software from scratch anymore. 20 years ago, there was no choice. If you wanted a system to get something, there might not have been anything on the market available to do it. But nowadays, generally, we try to find something off the shelf that's got much more feature and functionality built into it than what we can develop from scratch.
This software that you're proposing we purchase, how long has it been on the market?
10 to 20 years. We've looked at a couple of vendors, but we've had about dozens of responses.
Okay, thank you.
Representative Bastillo.
Sharon Pacilla, District 3. Do any other towns within MetroCog use a similar permitting system like the one that you're proposing that we use?
Yes, one of the ones, I think it's the one that's actually in your packet, I think is used by Stratford. Bridgeport is also in the process of implementing the system. Westport is, they're not in the MetroCog conference, but they're neighbors to the west. They're also looking to stand up a system this month. A number of our neighbors have done something. It would be nice if maybe all of the neighbors would agree on a similar system so that we could share. If you you are a contractor working in multiple towns along the coast and you only have to log into one system to get all of your permits in all the towns, that would have been nice. Unfortunately, it does seem that each town has kind of chosen something.
Yes, so that was my question. So it seems to make sense, like if MetroCog is going to, you know, has made a decision about using, you know, this document system, why can't we be showing initiative within MetroCog with these systems needs to try to take advantage of the fact that we have a few towns that all need the same thing, and therefore, if our implementation needs are similar, the economies of scale would be there, you know, to be able to implement something across five municipalities instead of one. I'd imagine that we'd be looking at a much lower cost.
Unfortunately, like I said, some of the municipalities have already selected a commercial system of one kind or another. It's already in some state of implementation or are already implementing. Trying to implement a system like this, speaking with my counterparts in other towns, it's a year-long or more process to implement a system that's in a mature, ready-to-use software product. If you're trying to migrate your data into a system that's under development and constantly changing it, you're trying to develop the system as you go into it, we could be in development hell for years trying to get a system. Our goal is to try to get something up and running in about a year, starting roughly in July.
In general, has MetroCog taken an inventory of where each of the towns are with their IT needs so that we can determine where we're all lacking and where we have similar systems gaps?
Well, I think MetroCog has identified an opportunity to provide the basic use document imaging system to the towns. It happens that we already have those issues in Fairfield, but the other towns don't. So if it is to them, it's a new feature or function. But we may still want to exploit the cloud version of those efficient MetroCog as offered. In fact, it may be that it could be used as an adjunct to a permitting system that we might understand.
So then my suggestion might be also, if we can see on the horizon where our other IT needs are, and we do you know, kind of a survey of the other MetroCog partners, there may be opportunities for us to you know, go out to RFP together on something that we might all need. Just a question if we've done that before. Other than letting like one town drive, you know what I mean?
I've only been here a couple of years myself, so I'm not, you know, that deep in history with what MetroCog and GDRC before that was doing. But it is the case that the Capital Region towns, the Hartford area towns, did get together in a consortium and do a group RFP and group buy. Actually, one of the systems we've been looking at in that presentation. Unfortunately, like I said, Bridgeport's already moved ahead with something else. Stratford has already moved ahead with something else. I think Monroe is considering trying to use a developed system, but their definition of a permitting system, again, is not quite what ours is. When we had the meeting a year ago, MetroCog asked them to see their proposal for developing a permitting system. My first question is, well, how do you accept an online payment for a permit? Well, it was clear at that moment that the people in the room hadn't considered accepting online payments. So, again, what we're trying to develop, what we're trying to implement here, is a much more sophisticated, mature, feature-filled system that will stay in constant communication with applicants and things like that. These are things that could eventually be developed using the document imaging system, the laser fuse system. I just think it would take us years to get to anything like what the current solutions on the market offer. In best case scenario, let's suppose that after 5 years of working through MetroCog, they developed this little permitting system that two towns in MetroCog use, including us, maybe three. We're going to be one of the only two or three towns in the entire world operating this one software system. I kind of think we'd be better off going with a system that's used by hundreds of other towns. There's some safety and features in numbers.
I definitely agree and see a point on that. So I think my only question is going forward for a longer range plan with IT, if there is a chance for us to do a group RFP like they've done in the, you know, the Capital Region, we might save some costs that way. Thanks a lot for all that. I'm sorry, we appreciate it.
Representative Georgiadis.
Just to follow up on Representative Bastilli's comment, I think you were misunderstanding. She's saying take the software that you want to buy, but go into a purchase perhaps with other towns. So, right, the 25-year old software, the company that you are considering, and do a group purchase. Is that my understanding of Representative Bastilli?
No, so what I was mentioning is while this particular problem will not be solved by us partnering with other towns, if there's another IT need in the future where we're all lacking a certain system, it may be advantageous for all the metropolitan towns to go in and RFP. I was just wondering how often we do that. So that was my comment. Thanks. Anyone else? Thank you very much for coming. So we move on to the 20-year bonds. I think I'll take the, we'll do the fire station rehabilitation first, Chief McCarthy. Thank you. Any questions for Chief McCarthy? Representative Goodbar.
Hi, Chief McCarthy, Silver Guard, District 7. This makes great sense to me. I'm just curious as to why it wasn't discussed in the capital planning session.
So, back in a very brief history, back in 2017, I proposed a funding for studies for a capital plan for all the fire department facilities. We were in the depths of the economic recession, the state funding issues, as well as a loss of GDP income, and the decision was made not to go forward at that time. I had worked with the previous administration of DPW since last year, anticipating the opportunity to present the budget with DPW, and given the circumstances over the summer, that did not happen. So we delayed the application, did not have the opportunity, given the workload of DPW under the acting director, and did not submit as part of the waterfall budget. That led to the recommendation from the Board of Finance to get in with this year's cycle and to develop a five-year plan, and that's what we've done.
Thank you very much. Any other questions? Thank you very much, Chief. So next we'll move to the transfer station renovation.
also, there's quite a few issues at the transfer station, structural improvements that need to be made. The idea is to basically get money to do a facilities plan and then to address some of the most critical issues, being the roof and the doors, and there's a list of things that need to be corrected. So rather than ask for a big sum right up front, we're going to put together a plan and phase in those improvements over the next 3 to 5 years.
Thank you. Any questions on that? Okay. Representative Gottlieb? I did have a question on the compactors. How many do we actually have?
There's 2 compactors. I mean, there's a request for compactors.
Right.
And to be honest, I don't know if one can address it.
I'm sorry. Yeah. We're talking about just the transfer station renovation.
Can we do the compactor slides up there?
I'm sorry?
Well, I'll be up here for the compactors.
Oh, okay. Any other? So I think we're done with that item. Representative Gerber.
Well, I'm sorry. Because on this list are the compactors from 2018. Which is not discussed in the other part where you discuss the compactors. So I don't recall what these 2018 compactors are, but on this list you're saying that those are inadequate. We bought 2 compactors in 2018 and they're inadequate.
Correct.
So we're buying
new ones.
Can you explain why we bought them in 2018? Why we bought inadequate? Were you here then? I don't even know. You were not involved.
No, I was not there.
Do you know the history of that?
Yes.
It sounds a little strange.
If you want to just go into the compact, which is a separate request for $354,000 to buy a new company. So basically, my understanding is when I took over the position in August, the compactors had been in operation since about January of last year. They were purchased, they were undersized, they are not suitable for the type of transfer station that we run. They just don't have the capacity, and they don't work.
Do you know how much we spent?
So those compactors, other capital requests, I believe they were, I think the total purchase price was $120,000 overall.
And we're just going to toss them?
No, so I spent a great deal of time trying to resolve this issue with the current solid waste recycling manager. Enviro, who's the contractor who runs the facility, basically knew within weeks' time that those contractors were not going to work. So I basically took over in August that there were the issues that were occurring. There was nothing that was going to resolve it. They were just not adequate. So we ended up putting out a bid in November. We went out and looked at the other towns because
Yeah, so the, I'm sorry, so the old compactors are
so the old
scrapped?
No, they were actually put into the bin to see if there's any salvage value for them. There is, they're basically the company's going to place $10,000 to take them out there. So we did look at going back to the original vendor, discussing that with them, because what was sold to us was inadequate at the time it was purchased.
Okay, thank you.
Representative Pastilli.
Sharon Pastilli, District 3. I think my question was just answered, but I was just, so when the original bid on the original compactors, did that include like professional services where somebody gave us some kind of a warranty or a guarantee that the compactors that we purchased were meant for the purpose that we asked them for?
No. No.
So we just bought them?
There's a bunch of back and forth documentation that in the process of putting together.
Okay, thank you.
Representative Steele.
Jeff Steele, District 2. I'm sorry. Can you enlighten me a little bit? How this happened? I mean, if I'm the only one here who doesn't know, then we can talk offline, but how did that happen? Did we put the wrong specs out? The wrong RFP? Were they delivered incorrectly? Was it the wrong, I mean, you can imagine, I don't know, astounding.
So the best of my understanding of the documentation is that these were purchased off of just a purchase order, didn't go out to bid. Sanitary, which is the company that basically supplied the compactors, we bought them as an emergency procurement at the time of that happened. Which is January 2019. It's in the box. It's in the request for the capital.
And so we're just dealing with this now, though. I mean, this happened in 2018. Notice to me.
2019.
Yes.
Yes, it should have been dealt with me. It wasn't. I'm not happy about you, but I'm trying to fix this.
I'm not blaming you. I'm just trying to understand how something like that could happen. It's a massive, massive mispurchase or something.
Representative Gottlieb.
Julie Gottlieb, District 5. Representative Gerber took the question. The reason I brought up the conference in the first place, and not to be a dead horse. And following up on what Representative Steele just said, I can't get past that these things are being held to operate with sticks and that there's no recourse after a year or two that's probably not how they should be functioning. And I'm sure you probably have exhausted everything you can, but I find that truly astounding.
These size compactors are not something that you can't just go into the Home Depot and purchase them. They're built to spec. They literally have to be built to put in the building. It's the person you were purchasing them from literally is going to come down and measure the site and build them to spec. So it's,
Representative Iacono.
Thank you, Mr. Carey. I know you're putting everything together, and thank you for your patience with all of us. There's 40 of us to deal with. You've already had a walk through two other town bodies on this. I know it's frustrating. So I understand there's been a what's the total spend on this error once we're all done? What, so we had to pay, forgive me, what was the original purchase price for the, for what? We spec'd that out at the wrong, we didn't put together a purchase order, we just picked something off the list.
So sanitary. Our equipment was basically asked to come in for the purchase of the equipment. And what they sold us was not right. I don't know, you know, what that discussion was at the time. That was between the sanitary rep and the solid waste recycling.
And so we bought that based on their, we called in a vendor that we typically use.
Yes,
correct. We called in a vendor we typically use. We said our stuff is old, it doesn't work, we need something new, it's broken.
Okay.
So then we said, I need to buy something new.
That would, in my case, I would say that is an emergency. You know, transfer station that operates, you know, 6 days a week. Contact or breaks.
Right, you've got a major problem on your hand.
Process the waste.
Understood. So then that happened in 2018.
Yeah, I'm just trying to find it.
This said 2018, but you said we bought them in 2019, so I was trying to.
It was like January timeframe last year.
Okay.
So they've been in operation for
okay, so again, forgive me for being so slow on this. So we bring the guy in, he says we need this, we trust his expertise, we buy it, it gets here, it immediately doesn't work. It's working, it can't keep up with our capacity. Is that correct? What do and what? How much did we pay for those?
I think the total cost was $80,000 each.
$80K each, and we bought two of them, so $160K roughly. All right, $120. Let's just go with this. So we spent $120 on these things that were undersized, and then what did we have? What was the spend? What did we have to spend to make do for the past year while these things didn't work?
Running about $20,000 a month.
$20,000 a month in overtime.
Which I can't not spend while this turn compact.
No, I understand
why this is a rush to get this done, sign these contracts, and yes, we get this.
We're a year in on this, so that's 20K a month times 12.
So, that, I've only looked at it since we did the July 1st budget, but it's been about $20,000.
Since July?
Well, I believe there was a little time trying to make from the previous fiscal year.
And then we're going to have to spend the appropriate amount. Now to get what we need, and that's your ask this evening.
So we already have bids in hand that have been on the stop list. There was three bids. They ranged the price from what we're asking for up to about $700,000. The three bidders were in the range between 260 to 280 to 700. One bidder was the high bidder.
any other questions? Representative Georgiadis.
Drew Georgiadis, District 9. Brian, I've worked with you for many years, and I just want to thank you for jumping in when we needed you, and thank you.
Representative Perugini.
Perugini, District 9, thank you for coming down tonight and for all of your efforts filling in when we need you. How many individuals were responsible? I mean, how many people were involved with the purchase of these inadequate compactors?
I'm still kind of looking at that, but the purchase, you know, solid waste manager is obviously manages the transfer station. So I know that there was an emergency procurement document that was signed. But I don't know what the paperwork is about. Who told who to do what or any of that. I'm still trying to figure that out. Maybe not all of the town attorney or nothing. Go back to the vendor and see if they're going to have some of the costs.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully we have some recourse because this was a big, I mean, it was a big disconnect, obviously. So thank you for your insights.
Representative Mahoney.
You need a mic.
Are we going to get any money from the ones that are not working for us?
Yes, so that is part of the bid. We actually asked for, there was a line item in the bid that had a basically salvage, I don't want to say salvage value, but that's really what it was, salvage value.
Representative Steele.
Just a real quick follow-up, just for clarification. You said that we found out they weren't appropriate within 2 or 3 weeks. You said the consultants looked at it and said, there's no way these are right.
That's what the facility manager said.
Okay, and I know you weren't there at the time, but why did we not do anything about it then, and why are we now doing something about it a year later? Why did we say, well, did we brush it under the rug for 12 months and 20 grand a month? Was there a reason it didn't come before everybody?
You know, I don't know. I mean,
months ago,
when I found out the issue.
Whose responsibility would it have been to say, hey, let's do something about this. We have an issue. Who would have been the person to do that?
Public Works Director. So, there's a recycling program. I don't want to sit up here.
No, but I asked you a question. That's fine. You're just answering the question.
Okay. Any other questions about the incinerator? Representative Gerber.
It's a compact device. It's a
right.
We're incinerating for Mr. Gerber. Mr. Carey, Bill Gerber, District 2. Just can you let us know whether are you aware of, is this part of like an internal audit review? Is someone sort of looking at what happened here and looking at policies as part of, I know we're looking at a lot of different policies right now related to the fill pile and what happened there. Is this, are you aware of anyone looking at this and incorporating what happened here into a review of our policies and procedures?
No, I don't think the procurement of the compact is wrong and so much that less of a procurement. You have a critical facility like that break, you can't sit around and say, hey, let's rid of red bean, getting this out in 6 to 8 weeks. I mean, that's just not akin to having a pump station break or something. You can't, that's an emergency. So, you know, this happened under, you know, my current watch, I would say, yeah, this is not something that can sit like this. But I think to wait to say, you know, this isn't working, then, you know, months and months go by, that's where the issue lies. You know, listen, people, compactors, I didn't know about compactors until this issue came up, but now I can probably write a book on it. So, you know, should there have been, you know, should someone have been providing oversight for the purchase of that particular compact? Yes. Do I think the process of purchasing them was wrong through, like, a bidding process?
to, I'm sure the Board of Finance has probably talked to you at length about this, but it seems like someone should be an internal audit, should be looking at the process of how this was acquired and whether or not anything else should be done differently.
Representative Tomlin.
Pete Tomlin, District 8. It sounds like we should replace this a few years ago.
We should have been looking at replacement.
Instead of waiting for an emergency, rushing out and buying the wrong thing, and now Mr. Durrell is looking for a buyer for these two things, and that's not going to happen.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I talked to my counterpart in Stratford.
Anyone else? Mr. Carey, what's your which items are you addressing in addition to those two? I don't have a list of which person is addressing which.
So I'm doing the senior center as well.
Okay. Would you like to talk about that?
So just like we're planning for renovation with the transfer station, we're going to do the same thing at the senior center. There's a lot of projects that could happen there immediately, but we need to kind of put together probably a 5 to 7 year plan over time to really tackle a lot of things. The bathrooms are pretty much original to the building. There's some roof issues, there's an issue with the kitchen, so we want to basically put together a plan, facilities plan, look at all these issues, sit down with the senior center and see what they need for the short term goals, try to tackle some of the minor projects within this capital. The need down there is really great.
Any questions about that? Representative Regani.
Silver Guard, District 7. Hi, Brian. Thanks for being here. So I've been in the senior center. I know it needs a lot of work, and I know I've heard seniors complaining for years about the bathrooms. My reservation about this is that we're limiting its use, because I keep hearing people in town talk about, one, that seniors deserve a different facility that's built for them, and two, the possibility of reopening old fields. So I just want to understand what this investigation is, if it's only relevant to use as a senior facility, if it's only investigating uses like the pickleball courts and a specific use for the kitchen that's particular to the seniors. If it is, I have some concerns about that.
So right now it is only for that use. I mean, I don't want to get into a broader topic about is that the place for the senior center? I mean, that's really something that the administration needs to decide. Because there are other limitations to that facility being a floodplain. But right now, for the short period of time, there are things that need to be addressed. Like I said, some of this money will go into a plan to put together architectural specs. So, for the bathrooms and the kitchen, the things that need to be, even if that place is only there for 5 to 10 years, then bathrooms need to be replaced.
But Brian, would it be bathrooms that are just suitable for older, for adults rather than children?
We would look at the plan. You know, I don't know. I haven't seen anyone talking about opening the school back up. Opening the school back up.
I just hate having this conversation without having a handle over all of our town facilities and having an asset management plan where I have heard Board of Finance members resurrect this. And it's not, I agree sometimes and sometimes I don't, but I just want to kind of like check the box and
make sure that we've discussed it thoroughly before we spend money on this and kind of reduplicate spending money again on some other kind of investigation. And along those lines, are we looking into Child's Garden? Like, in this investigation of that whole facility, is the square footage being counted?
It's not written scope.
Okay. But for the square footage that's included in this proposal, does that include a Child's Garden, or is that only the portion that's being occupied by the senior center right now?
So, again, when we do the facilities plan, we look at the needs and uses of the facility itself, and then basically come up with a plan designed around the needs and uses of that property. But the intent of this was to kind of immediately address some of the issues like the bathrooms and kitchens. I mean, it's just, you know, we have seniors using bathroom facilities that are original to the school. And there's, you know, like any building, there's going to be, there needs to be a payment and things like that before we can do some work. So while $100,000 sounds like a lot of money, we start opening walls in school that's, you know, that's built in the 60s. So that's quick.
Yeah, that scares me.
Representative McDermott.
Mark McDermott, District 7. Brian, thanks for being here tonight. You look exhausted, so we should have had you come up first. You mentioned roof work. There was some roof work done there last year. What is it not completed? What did that entail?
I'd have to talk to Jay Brown about that directly, but I think he said that there was a couple of weeks, like, this year, and the roof setting is some of the better. I don't know what details about that.
Representative Garcia.
Thank you. So I'm not sure if Dr. Carey or Mrs. Posse, but I'm just curious. It's a sort of a design project, but it's a 20-year bond. Is that typical that we would do a design project for a 20-year bond, or might it be more typically 10 years?
Yes, so the intent is to basically do the design and then also try to get some of the money.
Design and build. Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? Thank you. Is there? Are you doing the Independence Hall boilers?
Yes.
Have feeling. You could address that.
So, the building maintenance director came to me after we did the capital plan. He said that the boilers are Independence Hall.
Any questions about that? Okay. Are you discussing anything else?
I think that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for everything you're doing. I'm thinking maybe Mr. Hurley is next. You can always open with a joke if you want.
I better not push my button. I guess I'm here for four requests. The first one being the King Highway Phase 3 design. The first two sections of the King Highway pedestrian improvement project is complete. The third phase was listed on two separate grants. Just 2 weeks ago, we received word that the Metropolitan Council Board approved the project for lots of grant and is forwarding that to the state. stage for final approval and for municipalities, the lapse of care is the more desired grant because it covers 100% of the eligible construction costs. But the town would be responsible for the design costs. And so we're seeking for the design money. The project involves new concrete sidewalks, curbs, and medians. Other improvements might be pedestrian phase improvements at civilized intersections, ADA-compliant ramps, and turf establishment. The proposed project will continue the most recently constructed project at Bill Avenue and take it pretty much to the Bridgeport line. And it will include a section of the Tungsten Hill cut off south by Andrews Diner to the corner. Over the past few years, 3 dozen members of the public and RTM members supported the similar projects and requested that we continue to seek more grant money for the next phase and we've done that. So I'm here to answer any questions on this project.
Any questions on this? Representative Gerber.
Thanks for coming. I'm Bill Gerber, District 2. Just want to just double check. You think the total cost to the town is going to be something like $240,000 to $260,000?
Yeah, for the lots, that would be for the design, and after that, 100% of the construction costs would be covered. The only thing we don't know yet until the final design would be if there's any right of way costs. Based on the previous projects that we had, it seemed to be the right-of-way issue for always at the intersections, and there's not too many intersections here, only one basic intersection.
And you put it, I mean, what you wrote was somewhere around 40 to 60.
Right, yeah, just the way it said it's going to look at it.
Anyone else? Okay. So I think the Bronson Road culvert.
Bronson Road culvert is in between the Hill Farm and Cedar Roads. Bronson Road, just north of the Winfield Village, it provides access obviously for the village and communities and residents in the area. The bridge was constructed as a stonemasonry arch in 1857 and was widened to the north with a reinforced concrete slab bridge back in 1970. The bridge is only 8 feet long, but it's 40 feet width. It's been rated by the Connecticut DOT as being in fair to poor condition, and is recommended for repair or replacement. The project will go out to contract bid. Engineering is performing the design for the repair or replacement of the house, and will provide the plans and specifications for the bid or contract bid, and work with permits on the quarry.
Any questions, Representative Bergard?
Hi, Joe Bergard, District 7. How much would a total bridge replacement cost?
Probably approximately $1.5 million. If we did a whole bridge, if we did a box culvert, which is a little bit easier to install because it's it could be around $300,000. So what we would do is we have an alternate item in there, and if the contractor would say, you know what, if you got me this extra piece, I could put the whole thing in for a certain amount of money. We might investigate that. We'll have it listed in the bid because it wants to give us much flexibility. But right now, we don't have to replace half of the bridge because the other half is relatively new from 1970.
It seems worthwhile to replace the box culvert if it's going to have a longer service life.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. Thank you.
I just want to say like 300 to like 350.
Storm system improvements.
service system improvements are for various town-wide neighborhoods. It's for construction improvements. As you might recall, back in September and October of 2018, and even again in the summer of 2019, the town experienced severe and more frequent flooding. Some of these areas that were listed, even in 2007. The purpose is to address as many neighborhood complaints and reduce the flooding potential in certain areas of town. In some cases, eliminating the storm system bottlenecks, increasing the pipe sizes, providing more drainage structures, maybe even more detention areas to resolve natural and utility conflicts and help reduce flooding potential and frequency. The proposal includes the replacement of undersized storm systems, installing bypass pipes, and removing obstructions and bottlenecks. One of the key things that we have to look at is, especially in the middle of the watershed, is that simply by recognizing the flooding issue, and we increase the pipe with just arbitrarily say from 18 to 48 inch, all we might be doing is bottoming out the next downstream neighborhood. So we have to be very careful. And in the list of, I think you've seen this right now, the list of potential neighborhood improvements, we thought carefully and looked at these and, we want to do the ones that we know are going to cause downstream impacts, the ones that are the easiest to solve, and also the ones that have unfortunately been hit hard 4 or 5 times in the last 18 months. So those are the ones that would be in priority.
Anybody have questions, Representative Wolf?
Chair Wolf, District 5. Bill, thank you for everything that you've been doing. The Rooster River happens to be, as you know, we've had discussions, I've been to meetings, that the Rooster River does flow into our district, District 5. It is a mayor, for people who don't know, I've seen it firsthand. We had a press conference down by the cemetery, so I've seen firsthand what the Rooster River is doing. And it's all due, I don't know if everybody knows this, but it's all, most of it's due to debris that just needs to be cleared at times in certain waterways, and I guess like Bill said, it's very hard to do. And you put patch in there to try to capture debris. But,
Representative Wolf, is that part of the storm? Or is that the Rooster River?
Yeah, the Rooster River is next. But on some of these smaller tributaries to the Rooster River, we do have some of the neighborhoods listed, like Little Brook is one example. So there are some that we can tackle on this. But the Rooster River detention study, which is the next one I'll be talking about, that's
the head of the
study. Yeah, that one's more of the watershed. So
thanks, Bill.
Sure.
Any questions, Representative Georgiata?
Hi, Bill. I'm Georgiata's district. In the fall, when I was knocking doors, I talked to someone at the end of Clinton Street. Is that part of the Rooster River? Is that, would that be addressed to this? It was a culvert there that the neighbor spent a very long time telling me that it needs addressing.
For the Clinton, that's not part of the Rooster River watershed, but it is part of some of the construction improvements. What we have done is, we did remove, like I mentioned before, remove some of the debris from the Clinton Street outlet.
When was that?
That was, I'll say, last summer, the summer of 2019. And we were able to get all the natural debris and some of the trash that was accumulated, and we created positive flow for that. If you want to go further, we have to do an excavation into the soil.
Is that on the cards, or is it on the back burner?
It's in our list, and depending on how far our money will go, but it's definitely on our list to resupply for the permit and have everything in place.
Thank you very much. Let me post it, please.
All right, we'll do.
Representative Bovee.
Hi, Representative Bovee, District 7. I have to speak up for some of the issues that happened in the Golden Banner area in my district. There's been an awful lot of fighting in the viaduct that goes under 95 on Grassmere Crestwood. That just happens every time there's a big flood. You just can't handle it. And I've gotten almost stuck. One time, headed out to Boy Scouts one day. And thankfully, I had the Jeep. If I had had the little Nissan Versa, I'd have been in that boat. On top of that, across the ball fields, the pond gets really high when the water comes down really fast, especially if it's been dry. And it's just the sheets coming across the field. And I know a neighborhood group and I got together with clearing out drain that was not remembered, and it was in the middle of the ball field before it was as nice as it is now. That helped a lot. I'm wondering, is that still being dealt with, and do we still use drain the pond for catch basin, and is there ever going to be a plan to change the drainage from going away from the residential area instead of which is what's happened now? My constituents and just the water goes toward their houses. I don't know why it can't go under 95 or away from the houses at least. Is there a plan for that?
Well, we have a permit in place with the Conservation Department. We do have some conditions for approval. We are in the process of trying to dredge. Dredging it, we would open dredge, cooling, and storage, and we do for a couple of additional feet. But then, by doing that, we could also put in a bypass pipe, which is about 90% constructed already. We just didn't do a final connection because the condition of the permit was that we had a dredge or some mitigation to the pond, which we haven't done. But hopefully, we'll be seeing a change to do that. And then by doing that, we if we know the storm ahead of time. So that one storm in September, we had no advance warning. I don't know if this situation caught that. There are other ones that we might have a hurricane remnant coming, or other storms we have a little bit more advanced notice. We could actually dredge the pond or drain the pond a couple of feet, and then that might give us a little additional storage. Might not solve all the flooding problems, but at least
the direction of where it's percolating out now?
Well, the bypass pipe gets underneath the ball field, it creates a Y, and one goes towards the pond hill, and the other one goes towards the 95 area. And this bypass gets tied into the pipe that goes to the 95 area. So, in that aspect, it would be at least diverting.
Thank you.
Representative Vergara.
Oh, hi, Bill. Jill Vergara, District 7. This is just so critical for our town, these storm system improvements. Thank you so much for tackling it and getting a handle over it. I saw the packet of emails from a lot of concerned residents, and so this has been a long time coming. It seems like there were several several flooding incidents that just created serious problems for residents, and it seems to be increasing for the entire town. So it's a really important issue to be looking at, and I apologize if this exists, but I often feel like as an RTM member, I have blinders on, and I don't get a sense of everything that's going on in town, but is there a plan for how we're going to tackle our water issues, all the
policy level issues? Is there a holistic plan that maybe we could put this on a 10-year, 20-year plan where we have a vision of how we're going to help each of these neighborhoods struggling with these issues so residents can see it and know that we know that it's an issue and we're addressing it in a long-term kind of approach?
Sure. With the MetroCog and town departments, conservation, town planning and zoning, DPW, engineering, flood and erosion board. With MetroCog, we created a hazard mitigation plan, and we have several of these items listed. We had some original studies that were performed by Army Corps of Engineers, at least a preliminary concept plan. We have a plan that's on the waterfall chart for South Kingston. There's also potential for small type projects. So these are kind of things that we've been working together trying to come up with what they call a resiliency plan. And we've been working extensively with some metropolitan flood erosion. And the chairman just started to meet the first select one just to get them. Or 10-year plan window, and we have developed that. It's a plan in progress, I guess. So to directly answer your question, yes, we are working on several of those issues, because there's no doubt about it.
Even just with these storm sewer improvements, is there a plan, is this one and done? It just seems like, when I read through the list, it seemed like there were a lot of areas missing. I pass by Riverside all the time. I see puddles there throughout the year, never go away. And Riverside didn't seem to appear on that list, except South Bend. There was one corner, but not where I generally see them. So can we get this on a sort of multi-year plan where we're constantly improving our sewer system? Because it just seems like something we should be doing as a town.
I agree. If you add up all the figures, it came out to like $6 million. And so we're only asking for $500,000 right now. But what I've learned is you show people a pilot program, you show that it's being done, the money's being well spent, and we're solving some of the issues. And then from there, it's easier the next time to go for more of the next phase. And so that's the intent here. Also a difference in terms of puddles versus people getting flooded, or basically people getting flooded in their house. So there's different levels. And so that's what we were trying to do, as I said. So for this $500,000 request, I'm really hoping to tackle the ones that got the repetitive loss 3, 4, 5 times in the last 18 months. And then maybe even some quick, easy, hanging fruit, 5 times. At $5,000 or $10,000, but hey, if we can solve a problem for 4 neighbors at $5,000, why not? We can use it. So it's a combination of different scenarios on that list.
Representative Wolk.
If you want to subscribe, just to add something to Representative Segura about talking about tackling the sewer system, a question for Bill. On a lot of the roads, I remember some of our roads, I got stuck, Lawrence talking about getting stuck in that storm that you're talking about on Stratford Road. That's a state road. Doesn't the state have to get involved in a lot of the sewage problems also? Just a question.
Well, we've tried. We do have ongoing discussions with the DOT. Haven and Millington. I actually did apply for a grant. We're trying to claim that track. We've been flooded a couple times. I had to close it housing grant, so it was really, you know, drainage was really stretched with the DOT and unfortunately it was denied. But we keep on trying. So, but we have and we will continue to work with DOT.
Thank you.
Any other questions? So you want to address
the question?
Oh, Representative Bovin.
Sorry, I'll be quick. Lauren Bovin, District 7. I just want to go back to that area around Gould Manor, the Holland Hill Road, Crestwood, Grassmere, and then up Quaker Lane. I know that's like the low point right there. I've seen geysers shooting out of the manhole covers and the drains on the side of the road as well. And I'm just really concerned about the fact that there's things we can do something about, clearing out culverts and places that we can access, but there's also the backyards of people. I know a couple of houses that have actually, there's supposed to be a free-flowing runoff that percolates down, and neighbors have stopped that by putting up retaining walls. It stops the flow of water completely. What do you do about that? Whoever gets there first wins?
On some things, what they do could be viable if they block the road from where it's supposed to go and it goes to, say, another person's property. There could be civil action against them. We do have some of the streets that are on our listed here. At the time, if you went to a couple of years, the property owner was not willing to take the time of easement. My understanding is that it's really consulted, so we're going to look into that situation. There were a couple of other smaller streets out there. There was one area where I think we could solve the problem by putting in a base and maybe solve the problem for one or two people. Unfortunately, development before inland wetlands, before I guess dogs were visiting the pipes, the Grassmere Brook, and the rainfall events from the 50s and 60s are nothing like they are now. And the whole culvert is all undersized. Like I was saying before, if I were to just simply enlarge that culvert, it's a very delicate issue that we will look at that. And in terms of blocking and stuff like that, we engineering or DPW will take a look and see if there's any blatant thing that we can certainly write about it to the home.
I think in the interest of not going too late, we'll try to keep the individual situations, if that's okay. Do you want to move on to the...
Lisa River, same situation in 2006-2007, and again in 2018, the river came over and overflowed its banks, flooded several streets and neighborhoods. After holding a handful of neighborhood meetings, DPW hired a consultant to perform a hydraulic study of the Lisa River watershed with a concept design of 7 strategic locations. The report showed that basically Trumbull Wall comes all the way down. 2 hours later, bombed out. Many people used to live in the watershed. The report recommended improvements at 6 locations. And the purpose of the project, obviously, is to reduce the neighborhood complaints and reduce flooding potential within the Mississippi River watershed. In most cases, holding back stormwater runoff through detention or a holding area reduces the flow rate and then reduces the amount of flooding. Benefits obviously to most people in the watershed. The proposal includes the hydraulic analysis, the design, the plan specifications, contract bid documents for construction of detention areas, in some cases, excavation would be required, but in most cases, a dirt, a berm, or a dike would be constructed to hold back the water and limit the environmental impact
Thank you. Representative Farsco.
Thank you, Mr. Hurley. I saw your presentation on this two different times for two different neighborhoods. It's a great project. I'm all in favor of it. I'm just curious why it's a 20-year bond. It's kind of a similar question I had on another one. It's a study. Is that typical to do a study with a 20-year bond?
Finances and the but typically, much like Brian had mentioned before, you have the design and the construction are usually hand in hand, you know, right after one another, and they just incorporate it all as the same project.
Sorry.
Definitely the intent is to do the study, and then once we get a cost estimate to apply, you know, apply for more funding.
Understood, thank you. But, Madam Moderator, could I refer this to Mrs. Bossi?
Sure. Mrs. Bossi, would you mind coming up?
Okay, so the study is the same idea. So if the effect of the study is going to last 20 years, that would be treated simply.
Any other questions about the Rooster River study? Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Hurley. I think that's it for you, right?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Representative Iacono.
Madam Moderator, would it be possible, I have some further questions for Mrs. Bossi regarding back on the cash compactor. Could you just do a little bit of follow-up there, just on something that I've been taught with what Mr. Cooper said, as a request?
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you. I think Mr. Gerber raised a good point. I know it's not the purview of the RTM, but has there been given thought to have an internal audit done on what happened with the compactors? Is that something you're willing to put on your list? Yeah, I think what Brian Carey said, I don't think it was a purchasing violation. I think it was an emergency purchase done in accordance to our emergency procurement policy. And for whatever I'm reading the specs, I don't think it's a violation of the policy. I'm going to talk to Brian again about it because he's researched this ad nauseum for the last couple of months. But I believe he stated that it was a compliance with our emergency procurement. But I know in attending the audit meetings that Mrs. Saxel said she was open to suggestions. This is something you'd be willing to put on your list based on some of the concerns raised here. Yeah, I can put on my list. I'm also going to send out the emergency procurement policy. And then I'd just be curious to know too what the role of the Solid Waste and Recycling Commission is in all of this, because it seems like it was discussed on some of their meetings and they had just sort of fallen on the wayside and, you know, never works to go through all of that and look and see what it is. But again, I know we don't have any authority to do that, but you know, I think I'd be curious to follow up on the whole thing. I think he looked into. No, I mean, our thing was, I think Mr. Representative Gerber raised a good point. If you're willing to do an audit, if you're not, that's fine too. I just thought it was a good point to raise. So we can definitely look into it. And we can use Brian's knowledge that we've gained over the last few weeks also, because it seems like it's a lot of work.
Representative Steele?
Sorry, I was just going to add, and there may be an emergency policy, and no one's denying that, but the question is, I'm sure that emergency policy doesn't say just went by.
I'm sure there were specs, and I think they went bought off the statement list and did all that.
I don't know if any of those specs were.
Well, again, we could use Mr. Brian's knowledge of what he learned.
It would be great to know.
Yeah, we could know.
It would be great to know.
Representative Gerber?
Yeah, just to follow, I would, you know, it, even if it's in. Was purchased within the current regulation that we have. Clearly, something went wrong, so maybe the rules need to be changed. So maybe we need, I mean, so I'm not, I wasn't really suggesting that someone necessarily did something outside of the regulations, but when you see a mistake of this size, it kind of makes you think, well, regardless of how rushed it was, maybe someone needs to look at it and say, we need an extra step in there to make sure that we don't waste $1,000, even if it's an emergency. Like, there's no emergency that big. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I agree.
Okay, thanks.
Representative Pistilli. Sharon Pistilli, District 3. I had the pleasure of serving as the chair of the Solid Waste and Recycling Commission for 10 years, from like around 06 to 16. Just as background, I went through and read the minutes briefly when that issue just came up. And there was mention in January of 19 that they knew the compactor was defective. So I think in addition to the policy, you know, us understanding what the emergency policy is, we also need, upon purchase, to always have, you know, some sort of warranty or some sort of ability to, you know, take action to, you know, if there's a mistake. So I think that's, you know, we should never enter into, you know, spending that much money without there being recourse of some sort. And it was like $108,000, according to the site.
Representative Tomlin?
Peter Tomlin, District 8. It sounds like it was a mistake. I mean, I'm not going to point fingers, but if you have to point fingers, let's start pointing fingers. There's a couple of people that are working with the town anymore that just probably fall back on as far as the state. What can we do about it? It had nothing to do with an emergency as much as it had to do with somebody screwed up in order to order equipment. And whether the vendors should have told us that, that's the point of why the best. I don't know, but.
Right, and I believe that's why the tele turned is not important.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay, thank you very much, Mrs. Parson. We're going to turn next to the Board of Education capital request, finally.
Hi, Christine Vitale, Chair of the Board of Education.
Good evening, Mike Gunner, Superintendent.
So before you have the booklet that lists our three non-recurring capital projects, it's the elevator replacement at Fairfield Ward High School, Fairfield Ward High School. Fairfield Ward to Middle School is the elevator and services. The Bradley Wing is a two-floor area. The elevator has been failing and has approximately not readily available to the point now that our RTM contractor is purchasing them off of eBay as we build parks to keep the elevator running throughout the school year. We're hoping to get this approved as quick as possible so we can move forward to getting the new elevator ordered. The lead time on this site development is 14 to 16 weeks before it can even be installed, so it's going to be a very tough time frame for the summer work program.
Do you have any questions on the elevator? Okay.
So Roger Ludlow Middle School has a cooling tower that has been failing for quite some time now. Our PM contractor basically causing a sieve at this point. Some issues with the corrosiveness inside, so we've started. also identified the trees that were evergreen trees that were planted around the tower as kind of a screen when it was originally created, which the needles sit inside and on top of the tower, causing erosion and rust to form. So part of this project would be to remove those trees.
Any questions on that? Representative Georgiadis.
Drew Georgiadis, District 9. How old is this water tower? I remember when the building was built, and what is the life expectancy of this tower, and has it met that life expectancy?
It has not met that life expectancy. It was installed in the summer when the building was opened, but we expect a 20-year life expectancy out of it. So it has not met, and we've identified the issues that we believe have caused this to fail before it's life expectancy.
And those issues are primarily the trees or other issues?
The trees and the corrosiveness within the piping. So we've identified the trees and we're going to be removing the trees. We've also identified the corrosiveness inside the piping. So we've begun a treatment plan for the water that runs through it. So it's treated with a chemical on a monthly basis.
So it's the wrong type of pipes, or the fact that the water, the alkalinity was not taken into consideration?
Correct, it was not taken into consideration. So we now have a contractor who comes out, tests the water on a regular basis, and monitors and makes adjustments to the alkalinity, kind of like doing your pool testing, so that we maintain a pH level that runs through the pipes that's not corrosive to the pipes.
Is that kind of testing unique to this filter, or should it be done in every single cooling system townwide?
It's not unique to this type of system, and we've actually just last year picked up this program and are running it through all of our buildings at this point, all of our hot water cooling systems.
Thank you. School-wide and townwide?
I don't know about townwide.
Please share that information with the town about you.
Representative Tallman.
Hi, Peter Tallman, District 8. I guess the question is answered to some degree. I used to work in the power industry, so I'm fairly familiar with cooling towers. And the chemical analysis of the water is critical. And a lot of failures of power stations come because they screwed up the water chemistry in the cooling towers. So we'd like to get some of that cooling towers put together. Thanks.
Any other questions? Okay.
So the last project you see before you was Fairfield Ledlow High School emergency generator. So the Ledlow High School is the emergency shelter for the town of Fairfield. The generator has been failing over the last few years. Once again, it's at the point of its life where the parts are not readily available, so that when it does require parts, it puts us at risk for many days of not having a generator to service the building. I know it's come up a few times with other boards about looking at possible need. Putting either a propane system or a natural gas system in, as opposed to running a diesel generator over there. A couple concerns that have come up is if there is a natural gas interruption due to a storm or something, we would lose the generator to perform the emergency shelter that is needed most. The second item that actually just came up today was about putting a propane generator in. So we will look into what size tank we would require, what kind of additional, we believe it would be additional cost to do this swap over from the diesel to the propane, because there would be more site work required, whereas currently we can take the existing generator that sits on top of the gasoline tank and lift them both off and set the new ones right on top of it without having to do any site work.
Thank you. I wanted to thank you, too, for the quick answers this afternoon to the questions of Mr. Representative Grauer. Any comments or questions on this, Representative Grauer?
In your write-up, you said you want to replace the fuel tank anyhow. So if you replace it with another diesel fuel tank, then you just use it to replace it with a propane tank?
As I said, we will have to look into that. I don't know if the generator can sit on top of the propane tank. I don't know what the design requirements would be to put one on top of that. So we're going to have to work with our engineers
Is your problem with this as in the electrical generation or the diesel that runs the generator?
The diesel that runs the generator.
Isn't propane less problematic?
It could be. Again, I just don't know what the output of the generator would be. We need to get the kW that we currently get, so I don't know if we'd have to upsize to go to a different size generator to get the same kW output as we currently get. And again, it could be a smaller, I don't know.
Any other questions on this? Representative Georgiadis.
District 9. Have you looked into the safety factors of propane? I know that sometimes those propane tanks can blow up, and given that it's a school, I would like you to look into that. Have you looked into that?
Correct. We have not looked into propane at all. It was just brought to us today, so we said we would do our due diligence.
Please look into the safety factor. Thank you.
Representative Monahan, you need to use a microphone.
Can you explain the formula used to come up with the contingency numbers? And also, there's contingency, and then you have other, referring to the emergency generator replacement, you have other unforeseen, they seem very large numbers. And then in some of your breakdowns, you include removal, $40,000 to remove the existing equipment, but in your other proposal, you don't include the cost for removal, you kind of included it in with a greater number. So I'm just wondering how and why those numbers are the numbers. Additionally, I would be curious to see what percentage of our contingency do we actually end up using. Is that padding, or is that, you know, where does that number come from? What percentage is it, and, you know, when is it allowed to be used? And
So the removal of the generator is part of the overall total of the price. I apologize if we didn't break it out in all the points. I thought we had done that. As for the contingency, we built the contingency in based on there may be some electrical needs within the building to better suit it as an emergency shelter. I know one of the issues that we did address after Sandy was that we have shower rooms that have power and lights, and we have a cafeteria that had power and lights. However, to get from the cafeteria to the shower rooms, there was no lights, so we had to bring in portable lights to set up. So some areas like that could provide it, to be able to provide lighting within crucial areas of the building that may not have been identified. So we put the contingency in there to help assist with if we need to add breakers or do a full evaluation of the emergency shelter to make sure that we are able to do it. As for the contingency also, it is my understanding that the bond is not, we request the money, but the bond is only given for the actual money that we use. So if we're able to come in under bond, under budget, or not use the contingency, then that money is not ever actually bonded.
Representative Steele.
Sorry, just a quick question. You said natural gas is not a possibility?
Not that it's not a possibility. It's not a recommendation possibility for an emergency shelter because of the possibility of an interruption of service during a natural disaster. Hurricanes, flood, storms.
And then I do encourage you to at least look at propane, and for several reasons. Obviously, fuel cost is a big factor in this decision, diesel versus propane. Natural gas would take me out, but and also just what is potentially more climate friendly and safer. So, I mean, obviously, I'm sure you're thinking of all those, but the cost of fuel is pretty important.
Anyone else? Representative Graham.
One other question. Could the gas company tell us if they've ever had an outage in that area to the life of the gas lines being in the streets?
So I can follow up with the gas company and see if they keep, I'm assuming they keep that kind of record, so they should be able to let us know if there's ever been an outage in that area for any particular reason. Again, we plan for the worst case scenario, so just because we haven't had the outage doesn't mean that couldn't have the outage, even as much as someone doing a dig on a side street and not realizing you're hitting a gas line and shutting it down could affect if we had an emergency shelter running. So we have to take into account all the possibilities and work, plan for the worst case.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. Thanks. I think we move next to the Osborne Hill roof replacement.
Okay, yep. So you have the before you have the $1.4 million for the Osborne Hill roof replacement. This roof has been an ongoing issue for just about a year now. Just at the end of last summer, we did a $250,000 emergency repair to this roof to get us through the school year to keep the kids and the faculty safe in a friendly environment. We are looking at the warranty of this company. The roof has not lived up to the full potential of the warranty, so there is ongoing legal action being taken against them at that point. But at this point, we do need to move forward to getting the roof out to bid so that we can get it done for this summer. Roofing projects with schools go very quickly, and contractors are few and far between. They can handle such a large project in such a small time frame. So we're trying to move along quickly.
Any questions on that project? Okay.
So the last capital project you have before you is the Fairfield Ward High School air conditioning for the cafeteria. So this was put into the waterfall chart a few years ago in attempts to equalize the two high schools. Fairfield Ludlow High School currently has a air conditioned cafeteria as part of the emergency shelter. Fairfield Ward we looked at, and with the administration's assistance, we identified an area of the building that would best utilized for all the staff and the students in the building, along with the town being able to use that as an additional space if need be for meetings, emergency meetings, any type of large gatherings they would need to hold.
Anybody have questions on this one? Okay. Representative Ringel.
Hello, Marissa Ringel, District 10. Thank you all for staying so late and being here to speak to us. Really appreciate it. I just wanted to know, when I spoke to some people about the Ward possibly getting the proposal of Ward getting the cafeteria and air conditioning, one of the teachers at the schools was very frustrated that there would be such a large expenditure on the cafeteria where students are coming in and sitting there for, or people are there for a half an hour, as opposed to the classrooms where students and teachers are there for 90 minutes at a time or all day long in the teachers' cases, and that you're not learning, you're not in a learning environment in the cafeteria where you are in the school, and there's noticed that the children are sluggish during the heated days. This teacher doesn't feel like they're learning as much on the heated days, and it's definitely a discomfort and very frustrating situation for the teachers. I just wanted to mention that, because I'm going forward, if we can just consider air conditioning to get the hottest locations of the schools air conditioned, that would be great.
So
Thank you. So
the Board of Ed has actually put a charge forward for us to investigate adding air conditioning to all the schools in the town. One of the reasons we've identified the cafeteria in this case is because money-wise, to add a single hallway to air conditioning wouldn't equalize the building. The cafeteria was identified from the administrators as equal for all students to be able to use and enjoy, as opposed to doing a smaller section. So then we would end up with the Fitz House completely air conditioned, another hallway completely air conditioned, and then another hallway or three that would not be air conditioned.
Anybody else? Representative
Wolf. Jay Wolf, District 5. First of all, I've been advocating for a long time for air conditioning. For Representative Corman, what you said, I'm totally in favor of what you said. I'm in favor of the whole building finally being air conditioned, you know, not just a portion. And that goes for all the schools in this town. Need to be air conditioning and don't have air conditioning. It is really becoming a health issue for our students and for our teachers. It's been long overdue. Nobody's saying it has to all be done at once, but I have to thank you very, very much for bringing this up and for taking a stance and trying to make this a reality.
Representative Thomas.
Hi, Peter Thomas, District 8. We're at the 30 staff in the schools.
knows this crazy question. Where are they and who's in charge of them?
So the thermostats, if you're talking about heating or cooling, in general,
I want the heat and summer, I want the cool, but we're not schooling.
In general, the thermostats are located in the classrooms. Each teacher has a thermostat in their classroom. That's not to say they have full range where they can go in and say, oh, I want it 60 degrees in my room because I always am hot, and they can turn it down. They are a computer-controlled system, and we provide them a window of 4 degrees up or 4 degrees down to adjust their rooms as accordingly. If their room has a lot of kids, they can turn it down in the summer or up in the winter, or vice versa. But they don't have full access to go crazy all the way down or crazy all the way up.
What about the hallways?
The hallways have general thermostats within them. A lot of them don't have, like, the traditional, you can see thermostat. It's back end. It's on a computerized system that our HVAC guys can look at and control and make the adjustments to maintain the temperatures.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Any other questions? Representative I'm sorry. I don't know what my problem is. Ali and then.
Just want to go back to air conditioning, back to the roofing. Are roofs white to reflect, heat, sort of absorb heat? Do you have to back to reflect heat to make the school kind of cooler?
Some of our schools, like Burr Elementary School, have a white roof. Most of our roofs are stone covered. Won't be reflected, it'll have stone on it, just like most of our other rooms. Very few of them have the white, like burn out the white reflected roof on them. The stone makes them give them a longer life. Once burr is done, we can anticipate solar going on for Osborne, I'm sorry. For the solar panels, we do them on a PPA program, so we'll lock in a low rate. And that will pay for the solar panels being put in. We originally looked at if the solar company would be willing to participate in the roof replacement. However, at the end of the day, it doesn't pan out for us to do that as a school because we would end up locking in a higher PPA rate, and then we'd be paying it back over the long term, whereas if we paid it up front, we are eligible for state reimbursement for the roof.
Anyone else? Okay, thank you so much. Thank you for waiting to wait in the evening. We're going to have the Ed and Rec Committee report next week at the RTM meeting. So we're just going to hear from Representative Vergara on the senior and disabled tax relief ordinance. And we're going to postpone the Robert's Rules of Order thing because it's... Unless you want to stay till midnight, we could do that.
Hi, Jill Vergara, District 7. I wanted to do a short kind of summary and clarify some things because I have gotten emails from several seniors asking me questions about the revisions, and that it wasn't clear to the public that this was limited to the two sections of the tax relief ordinance. It's not the entire ordinance. It's limited to the medical deduction language in qualifying income, and the deferral section only in, as it pertains to collection of names. So I'm just going to get the pertinent language out, and I'll explain it. So for the first provision with the medical deduction language, there were two main revisions. One was removing the ceiling of 30% for someone to be able to deduct their medical expenses. For the way the ordinance was written, for someone to be able to deduct any of their medical expenses, they would have to raise to the point where it was 30% of their income, which is a very high bar. It far exceeded many other municipalities, and it exceeded the federal standard. So we matched it to what the federal standard would be, which is what most other towns do. It used to be 7.5% of your income, and the Trump tax plan changed it to 10%. We don't refer to it specifically so that we give it the wiggle room. If it ever changes, then we're just referring to the IRS regulation. And that way, I think a lot more people can be helped. Right now, we have 40 people out of the about 1,300 who participate in our tax relief programs who actually deduct medical expenses. With the problem that we were trying to correct, one person had been kicked out of the program because of the new way the assessor had been calculating the medical deduction. And 18 people had gotten reduced benefits. So our correction is not only to change that threshold, but it's also to make it very clear about how the tax assessor is supposed to calculate it. He had been taking qualifying income and deducting, he was only deducting every dollar above the 30% threshold. So it's very complicated. Equation. Before him, the other tax assessor was doing it very straightforwardly, where he would do qualifying income less whatever medical expenses the person had once they had approached that threshold. So we clarified the language to make sure that all assessors going forward know that qualifying income is to be calculated by income less medical expenses, 100% of the medical. And then for the tax deferral liens, it was really just giving a time frame for a collection. And since we have discussed it in LNA, the town attorney has also suggested removing one clause that he thought was redundant. I have extra copies, if anybody's interested in seeing it, in Section B, so it's 95-15B. Right now it reads, upon conveyance of the real property subject to taxation, that clause subject to taxation is redundant and we can take it out. So I was going to propose that at the next meeting. And then for the other revisions, the Fuller Ordinance, the Board of Finance Subcommittee was supposed to meet two or three weeks ago, and it was canceled. I haven't heard about a rescheduling, but I'm hopeful that they will be able to meet because they have to get those changes to the Board of Finance by March for us to be able to act and have the changes to benefits for people be effective this fiscal year. So I'm hopeful that that will happen because that would also help a lot of people.
Anybody have questions? Thank you very much. So now we'll meet as committees.